Now back to the show. This is The Law Show on CL 650.
That's the power of love.
And welcome back to The Law Show. Joe Murphy at Murphy Batista and Joe Batista at Murphy Batista are joining me in studio, both QC. Who got the QC first?
I did.
Oh, okay. Was that a competition, Joe?
No. I think those things are more important when you don't have them. Once you have them, it's just initials after your name.
That's true. That's absolutely true.
Queen's Council is what it stands for.
That's right.
Right.
That's right.
All right. So we had pets at the beginning of the show, and now we're switching to powers of attorney. So quickly, who wants to take it on? Can you explain this? Can you give us the 30,000 foot? What exactly is power of attorney?
Normally, when someone is of sound mind, they make decisions for themselves. We all do that. Financially, healthcare, and all those important decisions we make on our own. If you get to the point where you don't have the mental capacity to make those decisions, there's methods of what we call substitute decision making. And that's where either by court order or by your designation, you appoint someone else to make decisions in your behalf. And there's three main ways to do that. And one is the power of attorney. That's the most common one. I think that's the one people are most familiar with. Then there's representation agreements, and there's comiteeship under the Patient's Property Act. All of those three things have pros and cons, and they all are meant to address different situations. A power of attorney is very simple. You don't have to be incapacitated to give someone a power of attorney. Joe and I have each other's power of attorney just to contract business. If he's out of town and we have to sign something on behalf of the firm, we do that.
So that's a business arrangement.
It's a business arrangement for us, but it can also be a personal arrangement for another individual.
So if something happened to Joe, are you the power of attorney for him for medical matters and things?
No,
just for business.
Just for business.
So you can dictate that it's for specific things.
Yes, you can, okay. Or you can just make it general.
Okay, okay. Now most people, it's their spouse, right?
Yes.
I think, Zach, when you get an older couple, and mm-hmm. I just went through it with my parents, who are now both dead, but each of them, when they were still quite functional, signed a representation agreement, which gave one of my brothers and I the ability to make medical decisions for them when they weren't able to make them. Mm-hmm. So the key is you've got to do it ahead of time. You can't wait till you're there, because then the person doesn't have the ability to sign it over to someone.
Is there a certain age, you think, or is it just your fitness level? But you can be healthy one day and not the next.
Yeah,
at 50, right?
You can have a stroke. You can be run over by a truck. There's all sorts of things that can leave you very disabled and unable to say, okay, I want so-and-so to make the decisions for me.
I think when you make a will, this is something you can consider at that time, if they're doing something, some form of substitute decision-making at that time.
So can you say, okay, I'll just give you an example. My wife is my power of attorney, but who would say that she's maybe not capable, then it would go to, can you do it like a will, where you say, this goes to my brother Bob. If Bob's not able, then it goes to the next person. Can you do that with power of attorney?
You can have multiple attorneys in a power of attorney.
Okay.
And, you know, you might change it. Like Joe said, his parents are elderly. You might make your wife your attorney now, but when you're in your 70s or 80s, you might have, if you have children, have one of your children. It's logical to have someone who's going to outlive you do mm-hmm, it. Mm-hmm.
So can you give us the pitfalls of not? Like, have you obviously seen cases where somebody doesn't have a power of attorney? What kind of limbo do they fall into? What happens?
Typically, it's in the business context. If you're running a business and you are it's a one person business, or you're the main person in the business and you make business decisions, you have signing authority. The business can grind to a halt if there's no one there that can sign your behalf. In a husband wife situation, quite often bank accounts are joint, bills are joint. Life can go on to some degree, but in the business context, quite often the business can grind to a halt if there's no one there who has the legal authority to make these decisions. So that's the one context where it can really put you at a disadvantage if you don't have some type of substitute decision making or another signatory or something.
But on the personal side, it's often when somebody's incapacitated to make decisions and you have to make medical decisions on their
behalf. That's when the need for it's triggered, is when they can't make their own decisions. So you got to plan ahead of time to have someone who can do that. It could be medical decisions. It could be financial decisions.
The question I'm getting at is, if you don't have it, what happens? Who makes those decisions for you?
There is legislation that says you go to, there's a pecking order based on your relationship to the person who you're making the decision for. So typically it's children, spouses, then it goes to brothers and sisters. There is a pecking order where they will approach them for consent to healthcare decisions.
But yeah,
but not for financial. You need some other type of representation, either a representation agreement, committeeship, or a power of attorney.
Yeah. So if you haven't planned ahead of time, you need to go to court and get a judge to order that someone has the authority, and that takes time, 2-3 months from the date of, say, a stroke or brain injury. So over that 2-3 months, it's limbo that the family finds itself in, which sometimes they can deal with, and sometimes it's a real struggle.
Especially for business. I mean, business is that going on every day, and you say to your clients, well, can't do that for 3 months. What do you do?
Exactly. Then you have to go the court route, which can be time-consuming for one, mm-hmm. and costly. So the other thing, too, is a lot of these things, you want to choose who's going to make these decisions for you. For example, healthcare decisions, you want someone who understands your philosophy on life, on prolonging life, suffering. So, you know, you want to make the decision and choose the person who best understands what you might want in those situations. So you have, if you plan in advance, you have the ability to choose the person that is most likely to understand and carry out what your wishes are. And I think it'd be really unfair to leave it to the law to appoint someone and have that person have to make possibly a life-saving decision on your behalf. And they didn't really want that. Mm-hmm. Because I think part of choosing someone is to make these decisions, to discuss with them what your philosophy is. Do I want advanced life support? Do I want to do not resuscitate? If, you know, and you can talk about, you know, well, if I can't breathe on my own, I want this and that. So this gives you that flexibility to really choose and talk to the person about it, so that if you have the misfortune to get to that point, that person can make a real informed decision and carry out what you would likely want in those situations. That's the main advantage to planning in advance, is to ensure that your wishes are carried out.
Is this also on a personal level, if you have a power of attorney that's maybe your spouse or a child as you're getting older, what powers do they have? Is it financial and medical? Is it everything?
No, financial. You cannot make medical decisions with a power of attorney. It's financial. Essentially, a power of attorney, if you can have it unlimited, in which case the attorney has all the powers that you have to do the things that you have other than medical decisions. The only proviso is that the attorney has to make decisions that are in your best interest. So an attorney can't start giving away all your property to other people. But essentially, they can sign contracts, they can transact bank business, all those type of things, with the proviso that the decisions have to be made in your best interest.
So where does the medical decision come in?
That would be under a representation agreement or a committeeship.
Okay. So can you explain those?
Yes. Representation agreements, there's two forms of representation agreements. What's called a Section 7 and a Section 9. A Section 7 agreement, and these are documents that are drawn up by a lawyer, but there are examples on the internet where you can do it yourself.
Do you advise that? Can they cover off everything?
You can.
The problem, just, Zach, if you do it on your own, you don't know until it's too late whether it was done properly or not.
Yeah. It's probably one of those things where if I was entrusting a lawyer to do my will, I'd probably ask him or her to do this at the same time.
Right.
So anyways, there's a Section 7 agreements that allows you to make some basic medical decisions, you know, maybe a general anesthetic for a root canal or and things like that. A Section 9 agreement allows you to make more serious decisions, but also requires a greater degree of mental capacity to make a Section 9 agreement. So, and you need some type of mental capacity to do both agreements, but you need a greater understanding to do the Section 9
agreement. So when someone's health is failing, you can't then implement this. Maybe their mental capacity is failing. Maybe they have early onset Alzheimer's, something like this.
Exactly. So you don't want to leave it too late. But once, it doesn't mean you can't do it, but it becomes a judgment call as to whether you have enough capacity to make these agreements. The big distinction between Section 7 and Section 9 agreements is that under a Section 9 agreement, the representative can make decisions to withdraw life support or to end life support. Which you cannot do that under a Section 7 agreement.
All right. When we come back, we're going to continue our conversation about power of attorney and all the implications of, you heard, it's quite complex, and I didn't really understand it was as complex as you've pointed out here, Joe. That was the voice of Joe Batista, and we also have in studio Joe Murphy, partners at Murphy Batista in downtown Vancouver. We'll pick it up next on The Law Show.
There's more of the show still ahead. This is The Law Show on CIAL 650.